Good morning, everyone. So today we will discuss another compound of boron family, and that is boric acid. Boric acid is another important compound that you have in your syllabus that we need to discuss. So as we did in the previous compounds, we will start with the preparation of boric acid. So as you know, boric acid is nothing but H3BO3. Okay. And how it is prepared. One of the very important way to synthesize is from calcium borate. Okay, so when you you dissolve calcium borate, or it is also called as colemanite. Colemanite, when you make a hot solution and then pass through it sulfur dioxide, what will happen? It forms calcium hydrogen sulfide, and along with another form of boric acid, which on further hydrolysis forms your boric acid. So here I haven't balanced these two reactions. Kindly balance them and add together to get your final reaction. So what you have to first, this is the world's most largest method of making boric acid. This is one important source of getting boric acid. Okay, another important methodology for making boric acid is from use of borax. So here you prepare a hot solution of borax and then treat it with concentrated sulfuric acid. So when you do that, you will get sodium sulfate and the boric acid you will observe. In both these cases, the byproducts here, the byproduct is calcium hydrogen sulfide, and here it is sodium sulfide. So it is, both of these are soluble in water. So when these hot solutions cool, these boric acid crystallizes out from the solution. So that is a very convenient way to make the boric acid using these two methods of preparation. Now let us look at the structure of the boric acid. So, as you know, if you just talk about the H3BO3, okay, it is nothing but has a boron at the central atom, and it is surrounded by your three OH groups. Okay, it is surrounded by the three OH group. Okay, now if I ask you, what is the hybridization around boron? You can easily say that the hybridization is nothing but sp2. So that means the shape is trigonal planar. Okay. And that is what is the shape of a single H3BO3 molecule. But in solid state, what happens is that they interconnect with other H3BO3 units via a hydrogen bonding to form a layered structure of polymeric H3BO3 entity. And this is how it exists in the solid state. So here you can see there are two BO3 units joined. This hydrogen bonding is kind of forming bond between these two boron, these two H3BO3 units. So this is acting as a bridging atom. This hydrogen is acting as a bridging atom that is uniting the two BO3 units. So this is the basic structure of your boric acid. Moving on to the properties of the boric acid, they are very soft and pearly white crystals, and they have a needle-like shape. The crystal shapes are needle-like. And they have a greasy touch. That means when you touch these boric acid, it has a greasy feel. Then they are moderately soluble in water, okay? And in hot solution, they solubilize. Then they act as a weak monobasic acid. They act as a weak monobasic acid, but rather than being acting as a Bronsted acid, that means the one which is able to donate a proton, as you expect, like in the case of HCl or H2SO4, they are all bronsted acid. But here, if you see the acidity that is arising, it is because of the Lewis acid nature. Okay, so what is happening is that this boron, which is acting as a Lewis acid because of the unhybridized p orbital present on it, will accept, hydrolyze the HOH molecule and accept one of the OH to itself to form this metaborate ion. And thereby H plus is produced, which forms the hydronium ion. So this acidity is coming as a result of the Lewis acid behavior of the boric acid. Now at low concentration, you have the formation of these metaborate ion. However, if you have higher concentration of boric acid, usually we get a polymeric metaborate ion, which has a shape something like this. So under polymeric condition, the acidity is very much high. Otherwise, usually they act as a very weak acid. So here, as you see that the BOH3 can accept the OH minus to form the metaborate ion. So that means if you can titrate using sodium hydroxide to find the concentration of boric acid. But when you do this, what happens is that you have the formation of metaborate, which ultimately give rise to sodium metaborate. However, as I've written down here, this titration doesn't have a very sharp endpoint. Now, why that is so? Because the metaborate that is produced here slowly hydrolyzes back to the boric acid. Okay, because of this back reaction that is happening, the titration values show a large error. Now, you can titrate boric acid using sodium hydroxide. Only thing that you have to do is you have to add certain polyhydroxy compound which can complex these metaborate ion, to form a complex ion. So once this complex ion is formed with the polyhydroxy compounds, what happens? The equilibrium won't be going in this H3BO3 direction because it's somehow complexed by complexing agents, which are basically polyhydroxy compounds. So they form a complexing agent with the metaborate ion, and the complex ion is formed, thereby preventing this hydrolysis to happen. And therefore, you would be able to get a much better endpoint while titrating with the sodium hydroxide. Another property of boric acid is that when you heat boric acid, it undergo a water elimination to form the metaborate, which is this is nothing but boric is metaboric acid. So this had to be corrected. So it is better to write this as metaboric acid. Metaboric acid. Okay, so to understand this, I've expanded the structure. So here you see a water molecule is removed. So you get a structure something like this. So this is a linear structure. Another thing that you find is that the fluorides, when reacted with boric acid in presence of sulfuric acid, it forms calcium sulfate, an important raw material, and also BF3, which is again an important raw material for organic used as an organic catalyst in various organic reactions. So this is another very important reaction of fluorite reacting with boric acid to form the calcium sulfate and BF3. Another important thing that you will find here is that when you treat a mixture of, when you heat a mixture or burn a mixture of boric acid with the ethanol, what happens is that you will get a green color. So that green color that is coming is because of the formation of ethyl borate. So here what is happening, the OH, the H is replaced by the ethoxy units. So that is why you get your ethyl borate in this case. Talking about the uses, Boric acid is used for me preparing enamels and pottery glazes and glasses as well. So here all you will find the usage of boric acid. Certain eye wash and eye lotions have these boric acid being used, and that's it because of its antiseptic and medicinal property. They are used in here. Further, they are also found in food preservatives. So when you see certain food items, if you look for it, you will find that boric acid being mentioned there as a food preservative. So these are the various uses of the boric acid. And as we discussed now, the preparation, the structure and properties and the uses. Okay. So in the preparation, the equations are not balanced. So I would expect you to balance them and write the correct equation. So in the examination, writing the equation in a correct manner is very, very important. So balanced chemical reaction is always important. Whenever I'm giving in the course any kind of equation, you have to check whether they are balanced or not. If not, you have to balance it yourself. Thank you very much for your attention.